Hello and welcome to another new edition of Egypt's Parliament. Today in this edition, we're going to host a prominent member of the Egyptian Parliament. We're going to delve into details related to Egypt's Parliament. Of course, as we all know, the second round of sessions has already convened, and there are several issues that are unfolded over the table of negotiations. Many laws are also presented for legislation, and many issues are raised. Egyptians are waiting in anticipation for this second round and the results, whether it could be tangible or not. And also, we're going to be discussing the 2016 U.S. presidential elections and how will it reshape the U.S. policy towards the Middle East, and in particular, the president-elect Donald Trump over Hillary Clinton, the Republicans taking over for the first time since 2016. Is it going to affect any change in the U.S.-Egyptian foreign policy? Is it going to divert the course of events towards unifying international unified stance towards terrorism? Of course, we're going to raise many questions, and we're very delighted to have with us in this edition of Egypt's Parliament General Hamdi Bkhit. He's a member of the Security Committee in the Parliament. Hello, General Bkhit. And let's first start off with the second round yeah. of the sessions of the Parliament. If you like to elaborate, as you started to convene.
I think in the second round of the Egyptian Parliament session is going to be more emphasizing on the interior issues, especially the economic correction, and same time the development of many laws on social area and economic area and security area. All of them are very important for the coming period of national planning or national strategic planning. So as Egypt is coming up to across this Titan area and this swamp of crisis that passed through the revolution of January till 30 of June, till the completing the map road.
The political and economic.
All of them, all of them are very important in the next session or the next round. So this is why this round is very important. We are going to deal with corruption. We are going to deal with criminal law. We are going to the process of criminal law, and we are going to deal with NGOs law, which is going to be discussed might be today or the coming day, or considering the
funding of the NGOs and
not the funding, the area of NGOs, all of it about its establishment, its process, its relations with the country and outside the country. Everything about the NGOs is going to be one of the most important issues is going to be discussed this round. Add to this some kind of laws that concerns social life as the law, women law, children law, and everything.
So are you going to legislate new laws in social affairs and women and child's rights?
Yeah.
Because also women have been the driving force for June 30th revolution.
This is
and
important.
They are awaiting.
It's not a matter of mocking such a title. No, important. Very important to deal with this. If we are working for a state, if we are needing a state
for the best interest of the state, then we have to perform like that.
We need to make these legislations to satisfy our needs for the future.
Egypt's parliament has approved the presidential decree to extend the state of emergency in designated parts of northern Sinai for 3 further months. President Abdel Fattah al-Sisi decided in October to extend the state of emergency starting from the 31st of October, but his decision awaited for the approval of the majority of the parliament's members. The Egyptian constitution states that the president may declare a state of emergency after consultation with the cabinet. However, such declaration must be presented to the House of Representatives within the following 7 days to decide thereon as it deems fit. Al-Sisi's decision to extend the state of emergency came a few days after 12 security personnel were killed in an attack on a point in northern Sinai. The state of emergency has been extended for 3 months at a time since it was initially declared by Al-Sisi in October 2014 in reaction to a militant attack that killed 33 security personnel. Egyptian state TV reported that the state of emergency is imposed in the areas from the Tell Rafah in the east through to Auja in the west. In the north, the areas covered by the state of emergency extended from the west of Arish along the coast to Rafah. Parliament Speaker Ali Abdel Ayal said in a short period of time, Sinai will be completely cleansed from all the terrorist hotbeds as an additional strength for the nation. Defense Ministry official Mamdouh Shaheen urged the members of parliament to support the army until terrorists have been completely defeated in Sinai.
So, in other terms, you're trying to say that you are working on priorities, and this is what the Egyptian citizens are awaiting. What are the priorities according to you members? It's women's rights, the social affairs, for example, and it's the NGOs, laws, the legislation that regulate the performance. There is also fighting the corruption and bureaucracy. Let me take it from here. I was going to ask you.
I would prioritize all these legislations to base or to one fact that we need to secure the country according to the national security threats, to face the national security threats. First threats, we are going to face threats from outside the country. One of them in the law of NGOs. This is a threat from outside and inside. One of them is corruption. Corruption is stopping working against the investment, the real investment in
the whole system,
in the country,
the
even
whole state system.
The management or the department, the management of the country itself, in all the ways, on all the ministers, on all the power of the national security, is always faced with the corruption. So it's as it was before on the head, on the top of the leadership of any minister of any department. Now it became spreading over of most of the employees, and something became like a disease defeating the country. So this is why we need to put this law on the first priority. So many other priorities should be considered. On the social area, we have to consider the women's rights, the childhood rights, all of them are. So as a country has inherited of 30 or 40 years past, now we are going to face all of them together, especially if the committees of the parliament are working together and in coordination. Some of the laws at the NGOs and the local
municipalities,
government is considered one of the main topics or the main laws that should be discussed nowadays. How many committees are sharing this discussion? Nationality. Local affairs committee, legislation and constitutional committee, all of them are putting their ideas and issues on this law. So this is why all the committees are working together in coordination to face these demands of the coming phase of development in the country.
let me take it from where you stopped again, and I'm going to repeat. It's very obvious to even rivals in, political rivals, the political factions that are opposed to each other. I mean, all factions in Egyptian society, that President Sisi is doing all his might to be able to effect all his efforts to the best interest of Egypt and the welfare of Egypt. He's trying the best he can. But this is not supposed to be a one-man. He has to be having some other elements to support him. That includes the government, the people of Egypt, and the parliament. But let me tell you that the corruption and bureaucracy are two harsh obstacles that has been there inherited for more than 30 years.
Let me tell you.
See the role of the parliament in legislation.
Let me tell you that the national security strategy is an environment built by four agents. The constitution, the factions with which we are calling the parties, political parties, the elites, opinions, experts, threats, and valid tools. All of those are elements should be considered when you are planning for national security. All these issues we have mentioned before are considered to be treated by all these members. The constitution should do something, parliament should do something, the parties and the factions should do something, even the threats should be considered, and at the same time, the best use of tools to face these threats is very important. So this is why we can consider all of them together. Considering one thing, the national security, as I told you. So the president is working on elaborating this issue. He shouldn't dance or shouldn't work by himself only. He should be, all his steps should be coordinated with parallel steps with all these members. I told you, in the national, in the community of building the national security strategy. So this strategy should face all the conflicts, all the conflicts, the questions, the cases, everything, the crisis, the disasters that might face the country. Now we are on the economic track, which is very important, very critical nowadays. If we couldn't face our problems really on the ground and take the decisive decision and face the hardships that the people going to face, if not today, it's going to be tomorrow. If we couldn't take such a decision, we are going to be a neglected country among all this community. And Egypt is not freeing or starting doing or starting using a national decision, a free national decision, should be supported with good economy, with good national reconciliation to face this.
And no political exclusion.
Everything in all the fields, even the political. If the president couldn't be supported with national reconciliation, how could he face the cases in the political field? I think he would face many hardships if he's working without considering these issues. So this is why we have to be reconciliated more than that. We have to face the truth on the ground as it is. We have to sacrifice whatever we can sacrifice in this time. We can try by the departments and the minister to make the best use of the valid tools, because the valid tools are many, but how to use it, as they are saying, a decision out of the box, as what they are saying, it's unconventional decision. Using the unconventional decision is the best way to face the crisis, because how the crisis is going to be built? It's a kind of misunderstanding, and kind of a bad or unhealthy environment built through this time or through this era, and many bad decisions had been taken. So this is why this complication had been built to face it today since about 30 or 40 years. If you are going to use the model of making decision as before, so we are repeating the same dilemma to go between what are the valid tools and what is the problem. Now we
the
have
the usual ongoing
usual but now we have to get out of this box. Now we have to get to
and move forward.
Yes, moving forward is the main target, is the main interest. But how to move forward in a good calculated steps,
right,
without any risk? Because if you are rising the risk, you have to rise the opportunity, which is complicated equation.
Calculation.
Yeah, you know, you can't have a hard risk, you can't have a less risk with a high opportunity. You have to balance between them. You can't balance between them unless you have a good methodology of crisis management, unless you have a good, the valid tools, unless you have a centers of gravity that you are growing it, supporting it to face the problem. This is the only way to in the strategic planning. So in the first initial answer, when you asked me the question, I took you to the international, to the national strategic planning. Because if you have a national or an obvious national strategic planning, you can go forward with very trustful steps.
And you can impose your will on others at the same time.
From time to time.
Of course, and this brings us to another important question. We all know that Chairman of the Human Rights Committee, Mr. Alaa Abid, have presented a list of 134 prisoners that are in detention, pending investigation, presidency, that are eligible or could be suitable for pardoning. Mm-hmm. The presidency has even more suggested that this list could be expanded to include the prisoners of publishing, of freedom, of opinion, of demonstration, unless they are not terrorists.
Yes.
To include the pardoning also.
Yeah.
This is a one step forward towards democracy.
Yeah. This is because the president has a vision.
Explain to us.
If the committee had the vision, applied or could be compared with the president's vision, I think they are going to be in a better understanding for the aim or the target of this decision to free those people on background of publishing or opinion or whatever, unless the crimes of
terrorism
and using weapons against the country. So this vision of the president could lead this committee to widen its vision to, or its measures, how to elect and how to choose those who deserve a decision of freedom. So this built on three things. The first thing is the nationalization of Egypt as a whole. If you are working out of nationalization, you are separating the country. You are separating on backgrounds. Second thing is citizenship. If you are growing or supporting the citizenship, you are going to support loyalty to the nation, to the country. And this is very important, to create loyalty to the nation. Number three, to approve democracy, which is very important for those who are fighting us from outside and from inside, that are reclaiming that we are not using a democratic system in ruling the country. We had approved that on the ground.
Egypt's parliament approved the new NGO law to regulate the work of civil society organizations, despite criticism from rights groups condemning some of its articles. The 89-article law was drafted by the chairman of parliament's Solidarity Committee, Abdelhadi Al-Qassabi, and 203 other members of parliament. The bill will now be referred to the State Council for a review on its constitutional consistency before returning to Parliament for a final vote. Speaker Ali Abdel Al said that the Parliament welcomes any comments from the Cabinet on the new law. The current law regulating the work of NGOs, Law 84 of 2002, will be retired once a new law is ratified by the President. The law mandates in its third article that all NGOs should make adjustments to legalize their status within 6 months of the issuing of the law by submitting all data on financing sources, activities, protocols, and programs to the government, and should amend their operations to abide by the new law. The operations of NGOs should be compatible with executive bylaws that will be issued later and must not disrupt national security and public order. Article 13 prohibits NGOs from working in areas that fall within the domain of syndicates and political parties. The article bans NGOs from involvement in any work of a political nature. Article 14 forbids NGOs from conducting field work or public opinion surveys without permission, and also prohibits NGOs from publishing surveys without permission. Article 70 stipulates that a national body would be established to regulate the work of foreign NGOs and their methods of cooperation with Egyptian governmental and non-governmental organizations. The body will include representatives of the Ministries of Foreign Affairs, Justice, Interior and Defense, the General Intelligence Apparatus and the Central Bank. Article 87 sets 1 year to 5 year prison sentences and fines of 50,000 Egyptian pounds to 1 million Egyptian pounds for violating the law's articles.
There is a political gap that had been failed to be occupied until this very moment we are speaking by different political factions and groups.
Yeah.
Only the president is occupying it politically, because he is the only core that is unifying all the different factions surrounding. Clear in the National Conference for Youth, how he was surrounded by many different factions who are opposing each other, youth and entrepreneurs and opposition factions and political groups and all this. They were all unified on only one stance, that is the president. But still, this is a problem. There is a political gap. How do you think you
as a parliament? The problem is that we do not have an effective and a real
political parties.
This is a question. When we ask,
when
we discuss this area, we are speaking about more than 100 party on the ground. But how they are, how they function, how is activities on the ground? You found nothing. The main reason is the law of parties that made while the era between 25th of January revolution and 30th of June revolution. This era has witnessed the law of parties. See the law of parties. It needs the signature, 5,000 members. I can collect it from one street. I can collect these signatures or this membership from one street. Is this possible? No, it's not with a weight, with a political weight. If you are asking about the party, you should look to the Egyptian map, all the Egyptian governorates. You should have sites and positions in every governorate. And even its membership should exceed 1 million members. Say that it's a party, a political party, to let him have the environment to play a vital role in the political life. This is not found on the political environment in Egypt. So this is why we need to correct this law. Something concerning the membership, something concerning the
supporters,
the spread all over the country and representing in all over the country, some of them built on how many persons or segment persons or elite persons that can represent this to be able to participate in the political life.
In an efficient way, so not only participate.
That's what I'm saying. So this is why we need to review this law to build strong parties. If we have strong parties, we're not going to have this political environment you are speaking about, unless the president, with his national support, is playing this role by himself only. No.
And still, this is not a one-man show play.
As I told you in the past question, we are losing one of the main elements of the national strategic planning, what's called the parties, the political parties. Now, if we do not have a government, or this government of Sharif Ismail had not exceeded more than what now, according to many crises, many problems, many whatever. So who is the party who can form the government or make the new government?
Who is the party who can
form? No.
Do you have anybody?
No one suggests? On the ground. Even if you are speaking about Egyptian support coalition or Egypt support coalition, no, they can't.
It's not mature enough.
Not mature enough. Doesn't have the elite or the members who can play this role. Who can play this role? So this is why we have to keep this government as it is.
Well, this would bring us to, given the fact that Egypt is one of the most or the oldest political institutions, parliamentary life worldwide, as we all know. But this would bring us to another question, which is that why the president was very keen and careful to be able to inject youth inside the parliament?
This is very important.
To be able to enforce the political life and be
But
able
this
to
is very a critical step. Viewpoint, I would say this is a very critical step, because the youth has spent more than 30 years without any good education, any good training on the political life. And that's what I'm saying. I'm honest. I'm not hiding anything. So they need some time to educate, to learn how the political life is managed, to know how a party or a political party can function on the ground. Everything of this, every element of this political life, they should learn it first. Then they can step forward in this area. But we are not going to stay as we are and say, let's have more time. No, we have to start early by educating them as the presidential program has started.
And I was one of the
teachers who educated those youth in Nasser Higher Military Academy. So I'm glad to play this role with many others in the Egyptian life, in the Egyptian political life. So this gives us an opportunity to make a kind of attachment between our generation and this young generation, under one condition: they should know inside themselves they need to be educated.
That they need to be educated.
So if they started knowing that we need more education, so this is the responsibility of other generation to educate them, and this is a crime which has happened through 30 years toward this youth. We didn't educate them.
We were marginalizing
them. We didn't
them.
Let them participate in the political life. Mm. We didn't give them a real chance to do something good, whatever it is. But if it was simple, even on the level of NGOs, but there was no NGOs. Mm. Even when we opened our door at the NGOs, we have faced the black view of these NGOs.
The ugly side.
According to many crimes that have been committed through these NGOs.
General Bekhit, also among the challenges and the worries that has been haunting the progress of the political map, our hasty trip towards achieving a full successful political map is an economic. Of course, they cannot be detached from each other. The again, the corruption and bureaucracy, but this time it's the municipalities. The government, the different governorates and the municipalities in general. So what do you have in store in the parliament, plans to be able to stand up to the problems that are related to municipalities' elections, the achieving a good municipalities' performance? What do you have in store?
So that depends on the main mission of the parliament. Mm. Monitoring, legislation, reviewing the budget, the national budget, reviewing the plan of economic and social development. You know what I mean? Mm. So if we are working through our mission exactly as it had been mentioned in the Constitution, I think we...
There is a law that is in...
This is yes. So I think with these steps, we can achieve something good to support the country and support the president and support all the other powers. Mm. We are not working in a separate islands. Mm. We are working in a harmony. So the mission of the parliament doesn't go different from the judicial power or the executive power. Working on the same boat. We are living or moving on the same boat. So this is where our work, our efforts should be coordinated. Should be coordinated. If the government is suffering from corruption, unemployment, complications, we have to design the laws and legislations that should fit these problems. So this is why we are a one community. We are a one community. We should feel that we are not separate. So the threats of the national security on every era, according to the powers of the nation, on the economic, on the social power, and political and security, military, media power, technological power, all of them has threats from inside and outside the country. If you could make a plan or make a map for these threats and deal with it according to our specializations in the committees of parliament and on coordination with the government, I think it would be better than being in separate islands and face the problem by myself. I think it's going to be easier, more fruitful, more actual on the ground.
Okay, speaking about specialities, you are a prominent member of the National Committee inside the parliament, and you're doing more than your might to be able to boost that particular side inside the parliament. Now, as we all know, that the 2016 presidential elections is convened right now, have finished, and the new president-elect, the real estate developer, Donald Trump, is going to take over Oval Office this January 20th. Of course, this came as good news to Egypt, and you can correct me if I'm wrong. What similarities do you see between new president-elect that would qualify him to be more suitable to hold or refresh the U.S.-Egyptian relations, political relations, than, for example, of course, Hillary Clinton is old news. Yeah. Ted Cruz, the former nominee, Bernie Sanders, for example. What qualifies him?
I'm by my nature, I'm conservative on or forming an opinion toward a specific president, especially in the United States. Mm. The president in the United States is not by necessity that he would support the national security interests of Egypt, but there are worldwide interests. One of them is fighting terrorism. Egypt is the only that fights terrorism in a straight way, in an open opinion, open interest. We don't hide anything. We are fighting terrorism on our ground, even outside our country. So this is one of the main points that would come together. So this is one of the main promises made by this president while the period of election. And so that gives us a good credibility to deal with the new president. Another thing that we should consider, every president in the United States is not making a good relation with X country and Z country, no. They are following a specific strategy. But the tools between the Republicans and the Democrats are different. The Democrats are using special and specific tools. Same time, the Republicans are using other tools. But they are emphasizing on one important thing. What is it? The American national security strategy. How they can achieve it on the ground. What are the national security, the American national security interests in the Middle East? Three of them are important. Assuring the American domination in the area.
Again.
All the way, not again, again and again and again. Assuring the American domination in the Middle East, securing the flow of the oil on the proper price, what's called the policy of petrodollar. Third is securing the national security of Israel. No one can deny that in the United States. And when I look to Trump, how he could be elected, how he has been elected, I would say one thing. This shock or this surprise is a harvest of a deal had been made on the last moment between the Jewish community and Israel and this president. I would say that because all the signs on the ground, on the media, on the public opinion, inside the state and outside the state, was pointing to Hillary Clinton. No way.
But Hillary Clinton, according to U.S. citizens, was a continuation of the old administration. But people, I mean, political analysts, they debated that Donald Trump, he came out of the box. He's an outsider. He is new blood that is injected.
No.
The Republicans taking over the House.
I respect this analysis.
This is not the case?
I respect this analysis, but I would say something. The Americans are not ready to try many experiments one after another. They tried a black man to rule the United States.
And now they're doing another model.
They are not ready for a woman to rule the United States. Now, even they started a revolution against the minorities inside the states, especially they started since 9/11. Since the crisis of 9/11, they started a new policy against the minorities. See the minorities? They give Hillary Clinton all their votes. Blacks, Latinos, women. Other minorities, Muslims.
Don't forget women also.
Donald Trump, Donald Trump had decided all this election in two main states. One of them was Pennsylvania, and the other one was Detroit. Because he made one declaration that he's going to raise the taxes on every car exported from outside, imported from outside. Mm. So the man is playing on the needs of the American, the Native American themselves. But Hillary Clinton played on the media, played on the minorities. The false public opinion, you know? But I would emphasize that for the last moment, Hillary Clinton was about to win this election, but there was a kind of a deal made at the last moment to give these states to Donald Trump. So this is why we started some a kind of statements that coming out from inside Israel and from Trump himself. One of them, Trump is inviting Netanyahu for a quick meeting in the White House. Before the election, by 3 days, Netanyahu said, Trump is the best president for the future of the United States. At the same time, yesterday, in his meeting in a program called 60 Minutes.
60 Minutes.
Yeah, in CBC, I think so, or BBC. Or CC,
NBC,
whatever the name. He said that Jerusalem is the capital of Israel. So what do you expect? Now it had become clear that Trump is signing a deal with the Jewish community and with Israel. And this is how to win the election in the United States. Let's look to the future. Depending on the freedom of our national decision, the interests of the national security of Egypt, how to deal with the Americans as friend, not as an enemy. So this is why we can draw a policy to balance between all these needs, national security, the Egyptian national security.
So, General Bakhit, in other words, you're trying to implicate on the fact that Egypt should always be standing on its feet, no matter what happens inside the United States, whether it's a Republican, whether it's a Democrat, or whatever, Egypt should be negotiating with all power countries starting from now on a win-win situation.
Right.
How do you think the president-elect Donald Trump, that is going to be inaugurated this January 20th, going to reshape U.S. Middle East policies?
Yeah. The military policy in the Middle East is going to witness a big change. One of the ideas discussed nowadays on the theater that the Americans are going to withdraw from fighting terrorism on the ground and leave it to Russia to do this job. But this opinion, I would say that it's not right according to one thing. If you are fighting terrorism in a country, you are going to have some influence in this country. Because you are going to arrange the theater according to your interest. So if the United States is able to leave Russia to arrange the situation in Libya and Syria, by itself, without any participation or interruption from the United States and its allies, I think this question is answering this opinion. He is not going to leave the theater alone to Russia to fight terrorism in the area. Another thing is saying that he is going to use another policy instead of using the contractors of terrorism, because we don't have a terrorism organization. Those are not terrorism organization. Those are terrorism contractors.
Mercenaries.
No, they are terrorism contractors.
And most of them are Europeans.
They are European taking money. They depend on taking money. Taking money and...
I mean, not Muslims.
Executing
They're not Muslims.
Something in some areas. Like what happened in Daesh, southeast Syria, and southwest Iraq. What they have done, all exactly typical, a terrorism contractor. I will give you some money to do something in some areas. Let me know, what is the ideology of Daesh? What is the political ideology of Daesh? The main interest of Daesh, nothing.
That's a repeated question.
Nothing, but killing, but killing and spreading terrorism all over whatever the area they are fighting in it. Why is this spread all over the map of the Middle East? Why is this spread in the area of Sahel and Sahara area?
Particular.
Because if you are looking to the map, you're going to find Boko Haram in Nigeria spreading southeast.
And Al-Shabaab also.
To Chad and Côte d'Ivoire and Senegal and Mauritania, then hitting Libya and Tunisia. So this isolating North and West Africa to the interests of some foreign power who are supporting tourism in this area. Who is supporting this connection to be active on the ground? Daesh in Libya, trying to centralize Daesh in Egypt, trying to centralize in Syria and Iraq. So this map is making kind of turning this area into a kind of deterioration that couldn't be controlled by whatever. So you can think first about what are the main object of centralized tourism community here and there. No, it's not ideology, it's not organizations, it's not policy, it's a kind of executing or supporting interests or the national interests of foreign powers, like what Great Britain doing nowadays. See the report that came out yesterday from the General Assembly of Britain. Majlis al-Umum, what the General Council of Britain, what did they say? They are supporting
the House of Commons, you mean?
They are supporting the Muslim Brotherhood all the way. Even they are finding some kind of comment and excuse for all the crimes they have been committed in Egypt while this area. Even they accuse the regime in Egypt that they are not following the democratic rules while dealing with the Muslim Brotherhood.
Well, General Hamdi Baghit, a prominent member of the National Security Committee in the Egyptian Parliament, would like to thank you very much.
You're welcome.
As we are concluding this edition of Egypt's Parliament, but we would request that we would tail this another one, because you raised very, very important and crucial items that we would like to touch on later in the program.
I wish I could have the opportunity. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
You're
sir.
Welcome.
And I guess this brings us to the end of this edition of Egypt's Parliament. Many thanks to all of you, and please do join us again in another new edition. Until then, that's a goodbye.